chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. And this is kind of cool being in Acts because this is talking about, we're in this little bit of the book of Acts because it's talking about the beginning of the church. The church begins. And so if you want to turn, if you got a Bible, anybody got a Bible, you need a Bible? You need a Bible? Hold on 1 second. Let me grab your Bible. But we'll turn to it. And
there you go.
So we're in Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 1, excuse me, Acts 1, 6 through 26, and I'll begin to read. It says, "So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, 'Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom?' He replied, 'The Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.' After saying this, he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and the cloud, and they could no longer see him. As they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. 'Men of Galilee,' they said, 'why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven. But someday he will return from heaven to the same way, in the same way you saw him.'" Verse 12. "Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives, a distance of a half a mile. When they arrived, they went upstairs in a room of the house where they were staying. Here are the names of those who were present: Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. They all met together and were constantly united in prayer, along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, several other women, and the brothers of Jesus. During this time, when about 120 believers were together in one place, Peter stood up and addressed them. 'Brothers and brothers,' he said, 'the scripture had to be fulfilled concerning Judas, who guided those who arrested Jesus. This was predicted long ago by the Holy Spirit, speaking through King David. Jesus, Judas was one of us and shared in the ministry with us. Judas had brought a field with the money he received for his treachery. Falling head first there, his body split open, spilling out all of his intestines. The news of his death spread to all the people of Jerusalem, and they gave the place their Aramaic name, Akeladama, which means field of blood. Peter continued, 'This was written in the book of Psalms, where it says, "Let his home become desolate with no one living in it." It also says, "Let someone else take his position." So now we must choose a replacement for Judas from among the men who were with us the entire time when we were traveling with the Lord Jesus. From the time he was baptized by John until the day he was taken from us, whoever is chosen will join us as a witness of Jesus' resurrection." So they nominated two men, Joseph called Barsabbas, also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they all prayed, "O Lord, you know every heart. Show us which of these men you have chosen, and an apostle to replace Judas in the ministry, for he has deserted us and gone where he belongs." Then they cast lots, and Matthias was selected to become an apostle with the other 11. On your handout, and it tells us to look at Luke chapter 24. Anybody want to read Luke chapter 24, verses 50 through 53 for me?
24. Verses 50 through 53. Oh, okay. When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple, praising God.
Praising God. Well, your first answer, here you go, I'll make it easy, is Jesus' ascent into heaven. This is when Jesus was ascending into heaven. And this is just another, this verse just is another confirmation as to what we read here in Acts. It tells us what took place. And that Jesus, was fulfilling what was told in the gospel. As we continue to look on, I like what this is telling us right here. It says, this was the last physical appearance of Jesus. This is the last time anybody saw Jesus. This was his last physical appearance. Now remember, during this time, he was on earth 40 days after his crucifixion when he rose from the grave. He went around talking to everybody, and there's a story of, you guys remember the story of Doubting Thomas? Doubting Thomas said, oh, if you're true, then you can show me, you know, you're going to have this. Well, Jesus stuck his hand out. What did he do? He showed him the holes. Basically, stick your hand in the hole. And Jesus is kind of like, no, I don't think I need to do that. Or you could look at his feet. But this just proves, again, that Christ was here. We have the two gentlemen, as I said last week, who were on the road traveling, and Jesus appeared to them. They had no idea it was Jesus until probably right after he left them. He appeared, was talking with them, and then he disappeared and he went somewhere else. Again, this is the proof that Jesus was there. But it's also proof that he has the power of God. And he can come and go whenever he wants. He just doesn't have to do what a human does. He is the only God-man, the only God-human that's ever been. It isn't like Zeus or Apollo or all those other people that we talk about, Hercules and Thor and all those guys, you know, that we can watch in the movies now. This was truly the man God that no one else could replicate or think that they could be. It tells us in verse 8, verse 8 is the key verse. It's the starting point for the GC. The GC is the Great Commission. The GC is the Great Commission. So what we understand with that is, it's telling them, he wants us to go into Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And that verse 8, I'll read it to you. Let me find it for you. And let me read it again. It says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. You'll be my witnesses telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. I'm going to go back really quick right here. Wednesday night we kind of talked about the Christian and Missionary Alliance, Living the Call. Their verse is Matthew 28:18-20. Would somebody read that for me? Matthew 28:18-20. Anybody want to flip there on your iPhone or... and just read those two verses. They're great verses, and it goes along with what we're talking about today.
Matthew 28:18-20. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. That's what we're called to do. And again, when Jesus went up, we see what took place. We see that he was telling them to go everywhere into the earth. What I like next, before we go on to the next one, is let's turn to Ephesians in our Bibles. Let's look at this verse, Ephesians chapter 1. And this is a great set of verses. And it's verses 19 through 23. Does anybody want to read?
Okay.
Anybody want to read that for me?
Ephesians what?
Ephesians chapter 1, verses 19, I think.
Mm-hmm.
19 through 23.
19.
He wants to use that as the Bible.
The one that says, and his incomparably great power for us who believe.
Ephesians 1, yeah, 19.
That power is like the working of his mighty strength.
Yes, can you continue?
Which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power, and every title that can be given, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. Keep going, 22?
Yeah, go all the way to 23.
Oh, okay. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be the head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way.
This is pretty plain and simple. It's telling him that he was given the authority to do everything. And he is the church, and we're to exemplify being the church. So even though we're just a few people here in number, okay, are we still considered the church?
Sure.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Should we be discouraged about that?
No.
Exactly. Why shouldn't we be discouraged? Anybody?
We have the Holy Spirit. There's nothing we can't accomplish without with him on our side.
That's exactly right. So can we, like it says right here in verse 8, can we go to Jerusalem, Judea, yeah. Samaria, and to the ends of the earth? Where's your Jerusalem? Where's your Judea? Where's your Samaria? Where's your ends of the earth?
The comment that my study Bible says here is a little comment that sticks out to me. It says, because of this, we should not attempt to work, serve, or worship merely on our own.
Right.
So that's important. We need the entire body, including Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit.
That's right. If we try to do it on our own, it ain't gonna work.
Right.
We gotta let him work in and through us. It's like if you got a basketball, you buy it from the store. Usually, it's not pumped up. So you gotta do what? You gotta fill it with air. Then when it's filled with air, it's gonna bounce, and you can play a basketball game. But that can be used as an example of a person without Christ is just flat. But when they receive the power of the Holy Spirit and that Spirit comes into them, they are filled, just like a basketball gets filled with air, to do what? To be used to score points, to pass the ball, to dribble the ball. Well, I guess it's a good little analogy. We need to be like basketballs filled up. Or football, you know, kind of like they said the Patriots last year. It wasn't all the way pumped up, so he could grab it really good. You know? Didn't work this year, but anyways. But what I'm getting at is we need to be filled. And when we're filled, we see things happen. Anybody ever watch a hot air balloon go up?
No.
Isn't that awesome? Well, one day
yes.
We're going to have to do it.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll ride in it.
No.
We'll wear a parachute. But what I'm getting at is that balloon's just laying down. It's beautiful. It's got a great basket that could fit 2 people to 20 people. But until you fill it with that hot air, it ain't going to go anywhere. And then once it's filled up, then they got to hold it back. Why do they got to hold it back? Because they just don't want it to fly anywhere. Well, the cool thing is God doesn't hold us back when he fills us with the Holy Spirit.
Right.
He wants to guide and direct us, but at the same time, we got to let him do it. We can't be like man who's holding on to that balloon because we don't want it to go anywhere. It's kind of like when we go into Publix every once in a while, we get a balloon, and the kids walk out, and they're all excited, and all of a sudden, it lets go, and whoosh. Either you got a crying kid or a kid that goes, oh, look, it's going away. You know, one of the two. But God, that's what God wants us to do. And sometimes, we're going to be that child who's going to hold that balloon as long as we possibly can. And you know what? God's going to use that balloon in that area. But you know what? The other times, there's going to be times when he's going to go, you know what? I'm letting you go. You need to go where you need to go. And the Holy Spirit's going to take you, keep you full, and place you right where you need to be placed. So we have to remember that. We can't ever forget that. Let's look at this next one. Turn over to Philippians real quick. Philippians is right next to it. You turn over a few more pages, you'll run into Philippians. It's Philippians chapter 2. And it's going to be verses 9, 10, and 11. Anybody want to read verses 9, 10, and 11?
I will.
Okay.
Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Read that, read verse 10 again, one more time.
10. That at the name of Jesus every knee should bow.
Stop right there. Every knee is going to bow at the name of Jesus. Every knee is going to bow. And we've got to remember, when every knee is going to bow, that's talking to everybody.
Whether they believe him or not.
Yeah, when he comes back, he's going to make a point to say, hey, I'm God. It doesn't matter who you are, you're going to bow to me. Doesn't mean they're going to worship him, but he's got the authority, he's got the power to go, enough is enough. We're not going to put up with this nonsense anymore. So here, this is what we're looking at. Christ's rise into heaven shows his elevation to a place of ultimate authority. Christ's rise to elevation. He's all right. Don't worry about us. He's good. It's okay. Christ's rise to elevation shows.
The dog's outside.
It'll hurt.
Oh. Well, the dog will knock him down. Just be careful.
So the two fill in the blanks right there is rise and ultimate. Because it's Christ rising to heaven shows his elevation to a place of ultimate authority. So why would you think his rise to heaven is going to show the ultimate authority? Anybody?
There's not too many that have done that.
Yeah, not too many people.
There's only one that's done that. I don't know
what
it
was.
What
was the one before that?
Verse 8.
The key verse for starting the
prayer. There you go, right
and
here.
Then there's, oh, there
yes.
it is.
Oh, the Great Commission.
Oh, okay.
Great Commission. GC is the Great Commission. I just shortened it because I would have taken up forever.
Yeah, by getting back to your question, I think by allowing Jesus to ascend, showing his God's approval, or God's that he's cool with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's
obedient.
He's not just going to let anybody do.
No.
You know, sit next to him, right? So.
Now, we'll go on. It's set. Hold on. Let me see if I'm at the right one. It says Jesus left to prepare a place for his followers. Jesus left to prepare a place for his followers. John. 12:26. Can somebody read John 12:26 for me? And then there's a couple more. There's 14:1-4, then 2 Corinthians 5:4. John 12:26.
I'll read 2 Corinthians.
All right, we got 2 Corinthians.
I'll take that one.
John what?
John 12:26, and then 14:1-4. All right, who's got 12:26?
I do.
Somebody reads.
If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. Mm-hmm. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor.
All right, now somebody read the 14:1-4.
14, right here. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going.
All right, 2 Corinthians 5:4.
For while we are in this tent, we groan and our burden, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life.
Okay, so if we have Christ in our hearts and lives, are we mortals or immortals? What have we become?
Immortals.
Immortals.
Immortals. We don't have to worry about the physical death, because why? We have already been taken care of in the afterlife. We know where we're going.
Mm-hmm.
I read an article about, and I've said this a couple times, but I've read an article about the morticians, and the morticians have a pretty good idea who believers are and non-believers are. And they said they can look at the person's face when they come in, and there's this weird expression on the person who's not a believer, and a relaxed expression on the believer. And they said they don't really have to do anything to the face. Now, I'm talking about people who pass away. I'm not talking like terrible atrocities that happen and things like that nature. But they can tell the difference not only there, but they can tell the difference usually if the families are believers too, because they come in, even though they're missing those people, they're at a much different frame of thinking. Yeah, there's a peace there. Now, we all are going to be jealous to the fact that we lost that person, and we're not going to like it, but in reality, we should be happy because there's no more suffering, there's no more pain, there's no more tears, they're in a much better place, and they've got a whole different countenance physically about them, and they're in a place where it's going to be pleasing to God, because they're going to be right there with Him. As we move on, let's look at, it says in verses 13 through 26 of Acts, in chapter 1, the apostle, here we go, ready? The apostle waited for the gift of the Holy Spirit. The apostles waited for the gift of the Holy Spirit. They were much in a room, similar, not that the room is this small, but they were in a room together. They were worshiping. They were honoring God. They were in prayer. And they were waiting the gift. Who was the gift? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was the gift. And it's awesome. I mean, I think it would have been fun to be there during that time to see the power of the Holy Spirit come through, because they said it was this loud bang noise, something like thunder. Kind of like the air conditioning, but much louder, turning on. And then the fire shone above them. And that was the power of the Holy Spirit. I think that's kind of awesome. I probably scared a lot of people. But you know what? At the same time, it was probably great. Let's move on to the next one. 120 disciples in Jerusalem engaged in earnest prayer, then appointed an apostle to replace Judas. You had the 120 there, they were already praying, and then during this time they were going to replace Judas. Judas Iscariot, we all know about Judas Iscariot. He's a guy who betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. And then it goes on to talk about how, what? He bought that piece of property and he died. And unfortunately, he split open. And that was the end of Mr. Judas. So as we look on to the next one, as I read upside down, it says the Christ followers were preparing for the gift of the Holy Spirit and the spread of the gospel. Okay, so as we go through this little bit of this chapter, we see, what are they doing? They've elected a new person, Matthias, to become what? The new apostle. Okay? They're also been engaged in prayer. Praying for each other, praying and preparing for what's to come. They also saw Christ go up into heaven. How many of y'all wanted to be where you could see Christ going up to heaven? That'd be a pretty awesome experience to be right there and see it. What else did we see in this chapter? Anything else that stands out to you in this chapter? Any particular thing?
I think it's an amazing time for them, because here they are, Jesus is leaving them. You know they got to be shaking in their boots. What do we do? They're doubting. And he gives them that great gift of the Holy Spirit, you know, to take them over, so to speak. And what a tool.
Oh, yeah.
A tool second to none. And it goes from probably, you know, seeing their Jesus leave them to being a sad time to probably the most one of the exciting times they could ever experience.
That's exactly right. If you take your little piece of paper, up at the top of your paper, it says, we are convinced it is only by the Holy Spirit's empowerment that we can fully express Jesus' love, compassion, and mercy to those who do not know him. Acts 1:8 says this, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Then underneath that verse, it says this, we are part of Christ's church, his chosen means to fulfill his purpose on earth, restoring a lost and broken world until he returns to reclaim it. Romans 12:5 makes this statement. So in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We who call ourselves believers, Christ followers, are one body. We're not separate. We're together. To do what? To reach out into the world. And I think just by a little group gathering, we have already prayed for many people that we know, for family members. And let's think about this. We're a small group, a part of a large body all over the world. There are millions of believers all over the world. And yet we can lift those people up to him and ask for prayer and guidance for their lives. So one thing I want us to do this morning is, as we continue this journey together, is I want us to all get acquainted with each other. But not only that, I want us to, as we move forward, if everyone would be comfortable with this, but each person, a guy with a guy and a girl with a girl, get a prayer partner. And during the week, call on the phone or at least take 5 minutes on the phone and talk with someone and pray with them. And then you can text back and forth your prayer request and be praying with them. And the reason I say we do this is we are to share our concerns, our burdens, our whatever the issues we're going through. And it calls for us to do that. But to do this, to lift each other up. We have the power of the Holy Spirit in us to lift each other up. If we're tearing each other down, then that's giving power to Satan. And we don't want to give power to Satan. We want to give power to God. We want to give power to the Holy Spirit and to Jesus Christ in our lives. And this is what the church was doing. They were building each other up as they began this journey. And the church began. This is the beginnings of the church. And they saw that it was great to love each other, to dine with each other, to be with each other, to pray for each other. And to have kids say, I'm not going into that building. And we can lift them up. So just think about it. Before we leave today, I've got a paper here, and you can put your name down on it, and it'll have two names next to it. And just write your name, and whoever writes across from it, that's going to be your prayer partner. And exchange phone numbers, exchange emails. That way we can be lifting each other up. Because really, that's what we're called to do, is to lift each other up. And as we're doing that, it's going to help us in our daily walk with him. I want to encourage you all, if you don't have an app on your phone, and you want an app on your phone that you can spend about 15 to 20 minutes every day having a Bible devotional time, it's called Mission 119. I've been doing it for 5 weeks now. It's a great app. And the cool thing is if you don't want to read, you can listen to the verse. And the verse will play, and it's probably a minimum of 3 chapters of the Bible that you're going to go through. And then once you get done with that, you hit next, and it comes up to a pastor named Pastor Soper, John Soper. And then he talks for about between 5 to 9 minutes and goes over everything. And it's very encouraging. And then you go to the next little area, and there's a paper that you can look at, you can read through during an evening time if you choose to. And you can go through these questions that he's talked about, and then it encourages you even more to just spend some more time with him. But the point of it is to get into the Word, to get into a relationship with him, and to honor him But at the same time, we need to be honoring each other and lifting each other up. And I remember the statement by Francis Chan. He made this statement. I was watching it, and he goes, I left the church. He goes, because I had this, all this stuff going on. He goes, it drove me and my wife up the wall. So we were like, you know what? We're going to go start a church in our house. And he goes, as it grew, we tried to keep all these little rules and regulations that is of human aspect. And he goes, and we got so big, it just happened, and we couldn't contain it. And he left that church, and now all he does is goes around and he plants churches. And he starts groups just like this, helps them get going. It's in San Francisco. Now imagine in San Francisco, what's taking place in San Francisco? There's a major movement of the alternative lifestyle people, but they're showing the love of Jesus to those people. And he was asked a question, what is your thoughts on the alternative lifestyle people? He goes, it's no different than what it says in Scripture. If a person is committing adultery in the church today, unfortunately, what do? We don't really do too much. But if they're in an alternative lifestyle, what do? Oh, we don't want you here. We don't want anything to do with you. You know what? They need Jesus just as much as the person who's at an adulterer, affair, or whatever the situation is. We need to show them love. Does that mean they're going to be in leadership? Does that mean they're going to have any responsibilities? No, because we're going to pour into them. We're going to show them God. We're going to pray for them. We're going to give them an understanding that the best that we can do as the body of believers to give them God like they've never experienced God before. So let's take some time to pray about some things that we want to see God do in our group. And before we do that, let's just throw some ideas out. What would you like to see taking place as we meet? Or maybe you don't want to meet, which you're not going to hurt my feelings.